smashing, crushing, crunching. An automotive bite to the deck. Hoods buckle, tires smoke, radiators bust. It's Demolition Derby, and it's like no other motorsport in the world.
We've had cars roll over, we had cars catch fire, we had cars that were really terribly crashed, and the public absolutely loved it.
People don't want to see cars going around, so they want to see the wreck. They want to watch the wreck.
These vehicles aren't high-tech machines, and the drivers don't have corporate sponsors or millions of dollars. But they do have passion.
Wow, the Sport on Wheels Demolition Derby.
You have a lot of built-up frustrations and things, and this is just one way that you can actually get them out and not get in trouble.
This is a road rage cure. They want to get their frustrations out in a road rage, bring them into the ring.
I think a lot of it is frustration. A lot of it is being able to smash your way to stardom.
Whether you're 5 years old or 90 years old, you can appreciate a demolition derby.
Seem like utter chaos? Think again. Successful demolition derby drivers have the act of crashing worked down to a science. In fact, there are more insider secrets, tips, and tricks to this game than you would ever imagine. Since it requires no special training or equipment, Demolition Derby has more active participants than any other motorsport in the world. Every year, over 6,000 men and women take the wheel at a Demolition Derby someplace in the United States. Largely an American sport, there are over 2,000 demo derbies held each year around the nation. And nearly a million fans show up to watch the sport that has sometimes been compared to the great gladiator fights of ancient Rome. Except these are iron gladiators. There is no professional demolition derby organization, so the rules and regulations can vary widely between different amateur promoters. But the main idea is always the same. Last car running wins. Most demolition derby events are held in conjunction with county fairs. Others are put together as fundraisers. A handful are regional or national events, attracting the best of the best from around the USA. Regardless of why or where, one constant remains. In every town, in every state across the nation, at every level of competition, drivers show up to crash cars, and throngs of spectators show up to cheer them on. The county fair is credited with keeping the demolition derbies alive and well. This is the level that attracts local spectators and allows first-timers to give this unique thrill a spin.
How you doing?
It's an anchor event that all the fairs now have automobile demolition derbies because it's a bread and butter event.
At this event, 27 drivers have come together for the Sumter County Fair Demolition Derby in Bushnell, Florida.
It's a thrill seekers event. It gives them that shot of adrenaline. And frankly, most of them, after they've been involved in it, it's in their blood.
The racers start by meeting in the pit area. They unload their cars and prepare for inspection, which ensures a fair playing field.
We're inspecting for anything that can fall off the vehicle, basically, like wheel weights, door handles. You cannot structurally reinforce the car in any way. You can take anything off the car you want, but you cannot put anything back on it. But as far as driver safety, chain the door, weld the door. The gas tanks have been taken out of their natural form and put in a tank or any firewall in back of the seat. You knock all the glass out of the car. Now this is not reinforcing, it's just making sure that the rear tailgate isn't gonna fly open. This car is ready to crash. He is ready to rock and roll.
At the county fair level, the competitors range from very experienced drivers.
A lot of demolition derbies, yeah, a lot of them. Say about over 200 in my life. At least, if not more.
To those with very little experience.
We've only did one when I lived in Indiana, but that's about the only one we've did. That's the only one I've did. Lasted about 2 minutes in the race, and that was it. We got hooked up on the bumpers, two couple front bumpers locked up, and I was stuck. That's it.
To those with no experience.
I'm the driver, and this is our mobile from Gant Lake, which is in Webster, Florida. We spent 2 weeks working on it. We hope to win some money. This will be my first one. I'm a rookie. But I plan on leaving here an experienced demolition man.
And those who do race in lots of derbies get used to seeing some familiar faces among the crowd.
Oh, yeah, everybody knows most everybody. I mean, I know all these guys here. We all run against each other. We all beat each other up, and then after the track, we're all friends again. You know, that's the way it should be. It's a lot of fun, a lot of work. We put about 60 hours in each car. Yep. Gonna win tonight too, hopefully, Lord willing.
We'll just have to see.
Good luck, bud.
Yeah.
Hey, you ain't ever raced against Big Bob.
That's right. I haven't seen Big Bob yet. Big Bob's probably gonna take us
Big
out.
Big Bob's rich.
This is the Gant Lake boys.
Don't just take it easy on me. I'm a rookie.
See, the best thing is everyone believes that they're gonna win, and that's what makes you win. If you think you can win, you're gonna win. If you don't think you got a shot, then you're not gonna win.
I'm Frank Roberts. I'm the promoter of Strang Roberts Demolition Derby. This will be our 37th
Frank
year.
Roberts and his family are largely credited with first bringing the Demolition Derby to the county fair in 1963. His company, Stony Roberts Demolition Derby, has been promoting derbies for 37 years across 20 states from Maine to Texas. Frank preps the drivers by giving them a speech with all the rules and regulations for his demolition derbies.
Stay off the driver's side doors. No hitting of the driver's side door. Keep your arms and legs and all your appendages inside the cars at all times. Everyone must have eye protection on. We have a 60-second time clock. You must make contact with a live automobile every 60 seconds. It's hard to do. There are no direct head-on collisions. Gentlemen, two cars moving at 20 mile an hour is a 40 mile an hour impact. Knock you stiff, and you will taste that steering wheel. When we get to the end, boys, it's all the way down to the last car running. Last car running is not the motor running. You have to be able to make contact with a live automobile. It's a thrill that you will have that you'll not forget. Believe me, what I'm fixing to do is turn a couple of you guys into what we call Demolition Derby junkies, because I'm standing here looking at them.
Although there is a fair with rides, food, and livestock competitions going on, most of the crowd files into the bleachers for the main event, the Demolition Derby. This is the first demo derby held at this fair. And more than a few people are excited to see the action.
Okay, Sumter County, you're looking at the area right now where we're gonna crown the first daredevil of the 21st century in Sumter County, Bushnell, Florida. This is a ring that we have, the concrete barriers. We're gonna have 9 cars at a time in here. It'll be a total of 27 victims here tonight. We're gonna crown, out of the last 2 cars running in each heat, the Sumter County 21st Century Daredevil.
Most derbies are run in heats. Tonight there will be 3 heats of different cars. The top 3 cars in each heat will advance to the feature or final heat. Those 6 cars will compete for first place and $450. The first heat kicks off as the drivers are introduced and pull their cars onto the track.
2011 season, Mendiola, Florida, John Black.
Yeah, I'm going to win.
I'm going to win. He takes it away like a piece of cake.
22 years ago on this, and I'm going to do it again.
I get the signal from Frank Roberts. We're going to have that countdown. Okay, we're ready to go. 5, 4, 3.
Heat takes about 20 minutes while the audience is treated to peeling tires, flying mud, and crunching metal. Most of the cars are eliminated relatively soon in the game.
Get that 409 driver out of there. That's Benji. That's Benji. Need an extinguisher over there.
In this heat, the remaining 3 cars get aggressive. Finally, one of the last cars gets stuck in the mud. If he doesn't move within 1 minute, he will be disqualified. Car 21 doesn't make it, and the other 3 cars win the heat. They will go on to the final feature.
There's the winner right here. It was wonderful. I love you. I'm going to beat you, dude.
Then the cleanup crews come in to prepare for the next heat. They clear away the debris of twisted metal. Some cars will end up in the junkyard, and others will be salvaged for another day. Tonight's event allows progressively larger cars to race, with the top cars from the three heats going neck and neck in the final or feature heat.
Let's have that countdown once again for the main event.
Drivers negotiate each other carefully, doling out hard hits while protecting their own vehicle. As cars get eliminated, the competition only gets more fierce. And what does this auto assault feel like for the people strapped behind the wheel? This onboard camera gives you some idea. It's a deafening barrage of high-impact hits from all sides. The cars try to do as much damage with the rear of their car as possible, protecting what's under the hood. A timeout halts the action to attend to a stalled car with its engine on fire. He's out of the race, and it's down to the last four drivers. Two of the cars are quickly removed from the competition with some precise hard hits. It's now a race to the finish line. Car 69 is stuck. He has just 60 seconds to move, or it's all over. He doesn't make it, and car 300 takes the prize. Although only one winner is declared, Frank Roberts has just turned about a dozen competitors into die-hard Derby lovers. The exact history of the Demolition Derby is a bit vague. The strange fascination of watching a car crash was probably noted soon after the first cars were introduced to the public at the end of the 19th century. When exactly someone decided to sell tickets and smash cars on purpose is not certain. But one man alone is largely credited with bringing the sport into the mainstream. His name is Larry Mendelson. And it happened at Long Island's Islip Speedway in the late 1950s.
I don't think that he invented it. It'd be hard to say who invented it. I've seen movies back in the 40s with wrecking cars and stuff. So I don't think he invented it, but he put it on the map. And I'm sure, I'm almost positive that Larry Mendelson went and patented the idea for Demolition Derby.
Before becoming a promoter, Larry Mendelson was a stock car racer. But by all accounts, even his own, not a very good one. Legend has it that one night in 1957, while racing at Islip Speedway, he lost control during a race. The car careened into the bleachers and the small crowd went wild. They were more interested in the twisted car in the stands than the race continuing on the track. This gave Larry a great idea. Why not stage an event where vehicles were intentionally crashed?
He wasn't much of a stock car driver, but he sure was a tremendous promoter. He took over the reins of the speedway, and he decided, well, how can I improve this place? He decided, well, hey, if I staged auto accidents, I could get a lot of people in here, pay good money to see this. And sure enough, he did. I mean, he was probably the finest promoter on the East Coast at the time.
Well, it was probably 1962, I believe. Well, probably around 61, 62, he started the first Demolition Derby. And he ran these ads in the newspaper. Wanted men, not afraid to die, you know, all that kind of stuff. And it just attracted a lot of people, a lot of drivers.
Larry knew that part of the fascination for both drivers and spectators was the seeming recklessness and danger of crashing dozens of cars at the same time. Within weeks, Demolition Derby became one of the biggest draws at Islip Speedway.
It was really a tremendous party atmosphere. Everybody went to Islip Speedway to see that show. It was hyped for weeks, and if you had any interest at all, you drove out to the Islip Speedway, you wanted to see this show.
Because that place would hold maybe 7,000 people or so. And on those nights with the standees, you had about 12,000 people. You brought in Demolition on top of that. There were six deep in the turn standing up. They could hardly see, but they were there. And Larry was right. It sounds stupid, but I'm going to make a lot of money. And he did.
The idea spread like wildfire all over the nation. Soon, Long Island alone held demolition derbies at Islip as well as Freeport and Riverhead Speedways. But Larry Mendelson was still showing them how it was done. He continued to come up with ideas to make demolition derby a true contender to other popular forms of racing.
The people brought their own cars. Believe it or not, you know, there were junkyard operators, there were guys in gas stations that had old clunkers. And he divided it into four heat races of 50 cars apiece. And after each race, the guy that was last running, obviously, had won. And he gave them a brand new car to go into the finals. And he paid the winner, the last guy running of the feature event, $1,000. And that was big money back in 1963. Real big money. I mean, it was a big, big deal back then. And ABC's Wide World Sports saw this, and they came in and started televising it. I mean, it was really tremendous.
Demo Derby would reach its height of fame in the 60s and 70s when the races were televised on ABC's Wide World of Sports. Suddenly, the entire nation was watching the excitement live from Islip Speedway. This was the heyday of Demolition Derby popularity on a national level. But as other sports gained popularity, ABC eventually stopped televising Islip Derbies in 1973. And a decade later, due to neighborhood complaints about the noise, Islip Speedway closed its doors in 1985. For millions, it was the end of an era.
First thing we see here is the sign that was over the pit gate at Freeport Stadium.
Nearby Freeport Speedway had closed down in 1983. Although the Islip and Freeport Speedways no longer exist, racing expert Marty Himes keeps their memories alive at the Himes Museum of Motor Racing Nostalgia in Bayshore, New York. In fact, some say the tracks are literally in his backyard.
It really spells it out. Through this gate, past the best damn drivers on Long Island. And elsewhere, too. There's a lot of famous people walked under that sign. These are the original lights that were around Islip Speedway, up on the telephone poles. As a matter of fact, the beams that are holding this building up are all built out of original seats from Islip Speedway. That's where I got the lumber. That's the original door from Islip Speedway, right here. It's off the Larry Mendelson's office. Everything that could possibly be removed by anyone was removed, and it's here.
Marty started the museum 25 years ago with a single photo of a race car driver. Today, he can hardly find room for it all. And just how does he get it all?
You want to know the truth? I just go and take it. That's the original Islip Speedway sign. It was like 25 feet in the air. I went to the state, said I'd like to have that sign. What do I have to do to get it? And the guy tells me there's a lot of red tape, insurance and all of that. I said, okay, thank you. I went back that night with a pickup truck, acetylene torch, cut the red tape with the blue torch. Yelled one word, timber, and we own it. And you know what? Everybody thinks I did the right thing. There's not a doubt in my mind.
Marty often reminisces about the good old days with friends tied to the demolition derbies at the Long Island Speedways, like Charlie Seuss, who was a derby driver in the very early days at Islip and raced in one of Larry Mendelson's first demolition derby national championships. His car of choice? A 1930 Model A Ford.
Everybody went crazy over the car before we had the race. They wanted to buy it, you know. That was on a Wide World of Sports. And everybody wanted to buy the car. Nobody wanted me to enter it. They voted me best car, and Larry Mendelson liked it so much, that's why he paid me to bring it back the second year. But I didn't do it so good. I bet the axle.
Over here on the left, we have the last set of flags used at Islip Speedway by Mr. Ray Martorano. And that's him waving them right here.
Another of Marty's friends is Ray Martorano, who worked as an official starter at Islip, starting in 1962 when he was just 12 years old. He stayed there for 25 years until Islip shut down. Year in and year out, Ray saw firsthand how racers fell in love with the sport.
If you decided that you wanted to run a demolition car, you'd see it advertised, you'd register the car, you'd register your number, you'd follow the rules, you'd prep the car, you go out, you race, then you enjoy it, okay? If you don't enjoy it, then you don't do it again, okay? But I'll tell you what, you'll do it once and you're hooked.
Today, only Riverhead Raceway still remains on Long Island. They still run demolition derbies and still draw a full crowd of over 3,000 fans.
Riverhead during the summer will get
on a Saturday night demolition derby, we'll get 20, 25 cars. And really what it is, it's an unusual spectator sport. And the people are the ones that make it. The fans are the people that make it. If it wasn't for the fans coming out, like any type of sport, if the fans didn't come out, it wouldn't be here.
Michael Buxa is a longtime derby driver, and today he also announces at Riverhead.
I've always enjoyed destruction. It sounds weird, but I was never one for speed. I never liked speed, and it was something I could do in my backyard where I didn't have to spend a whole lot of money. And it seemed the way to go. And after a couple of years, I got really good at it. And when you get good at something, you want to keep doing it.
Jim Cromarty has helped keep the sport alive. He and his wife Barbara managed Islip Speedway in the 80s, and today they own Riverhead.
Demolition Derby is something that anyone who comes to the racetrack can enjoy. A lot of people, if they don't understand racing, and for the first couple of times you come to see a race, it's difficult to tell where the cars are, who's leading, what's going on. Demolition Derby, you can come, and from the first time you see a Demolition Derby, you know what's going on. And that's, I think that's the thing that makes it exciting, because it just pertains to everybody. Whether you're 5 years old or 90 years old, you can appreciate a Demolition Derby.
And if you can legally drive a car, you can actually compete in a Demolition Derby as well. There's a lot more talent, skill, and creativity required than meets the eye.
We're not a bunch of yahoos going out drunk and stupid. We have full-time jobs. A lot of us are family men. We have a wife and kids, or we have a husband and kids. A typical demolition derby driver is your typical person walking down the street. We've had doctors, lawyers, we've had ladies come out and run the demolition derby. We've had a couple of women win the demolition derby. So it's to put a type of person, you really can't, because they come from all walks of life.
Lisa Finch of Westport, Kentucky is one of the most successful female drivers out there, and one of the few who have shunned the traditional all-women powder puff derbies to run with the men.
I got into demolition derbies by helping a friend of ours in the pit, my husband and I, and so I figured one day, you know, I'd like to try it just once. And so I asked him to build me one car, and that's been 4 years ago, and several cars later, and I'm still doing it. So it's either you either love it or you hate it, and I love it.
When she first started, she was picked on quite a bit. A lot of the friends that we have that drive, they helped her out getting started. When one would, or when a couple of them would team up on her, then they would be there to help her out. She has earned the respect of a lot of them, and it's a different ball game now.
I'm not real sure how many women run in derbies. It's growing. There's more and more women getting into the sport every day. Wherever I go, I notice more and more women, which is great.
Let's go to pit.
My husband thinks it's great. He cheers it on. He likes to see how well he can build the cars, see how tough he can make them, and of course, he's my number one fan.
I love watching her. She's aggressive when she needs to be. She's conservative when she needs to be. I enjoy seeing how long my cars will last. It's a lot of fun, and it is something that we do as a family, so it makes it more enjoyable.
I think women are great drivers. There's good women drivers, there's good men drivers, and vice versa. I don't think it has anything to do with our sexuality on how well we drive.
The highlight of Lisa's season is competing in the Derby near her hometown.
My hometown Derby is naturally my favorite Derby. Reason being, you have friends, family, people that come, you know, to watch. A lot of out-of-town derbies. Just whomever goes with you is the only people that you actually know there.
While almost anybody can race in a demolition derby, only a relatively few car models make the grade to enter the ring. Everyone who knows derby agrees that certain cars dominate the sport. The best cars to drive are the full-frame cars from the 60s and 70s. After that, cars were downsized for fuel economy and designed to easily crumple on impact to protect the passenger.
best car we found for a demolition derby is a 74 to 76 Chevy Impala because of the strength of the frame and their construction. It seems to be for us the toughest car that possibly is, and it's a favorite of many derby drivers. There's out of 100 cars at the demolition derby we're going to, there'll be probably 90 of them that'll be Chevy Impala.
General Motors has a certain pride about their cars being cherished for their success in the ring. Greg Bellopatrick is the vehicle chief engineer for the Chevy Impala.
Impala is probably one of the most popular cars in the auto industry from a brand recognition standpoint. It's kind of the Coca-Cola, if you will, of automobiles.
Between 1974 and 1976 alone, over 1.5 million Impalas were produced, which has made the cars and their parts readily available for derbies. But availability isn't enough. Impalas have a few technical reasons for demonstrating the survival of the fittest in the ring.
Well, if you're in demolition derby with a 1970s Impala, probably the biggest single enabler has got to be the full frame underneath the vehicle, because it just basically creates a structural platform for you that the body and that's attached to, and it protects all the critical elements as well as basically takes care of absorbing all the energy during an impact. It's probably your number one success factor. The other thing that you got going for you with the 1970s Impalas in a demolition derby is just the amount of ample room, for example, in the motor compartment. If you look at the amount of space between the radiator and the engine itself, there's a lot of space there to keep from damaging that very delicate cooling system and losing that, which will allow the engine then to overheat, and as a result of that, you're immediately out of the race. And then finally, the last consideration of the 1970s Impala is this issue of mass, just given the fact that it weighed in the neighborhood of 4,000 to 4,200 pounds.
Professor Mohammed El Sayed studies crash worthiness and durability for a living, and he has spent many years studying the GM models.
If we go back to the definition of durability is the ability of the product to withstand the environment. And none of the design engineers really design a car for demolition derby. But in their strive to make stronger cars, they built a car that can go through the demolition derby and perform very well. And that was the era. Stronger is the better, as long as we can give it the muscle to move. And the customers felt safe in bigger and stronger cars. That was really the philosophy, and that's why you get some of the best cars around that time.
After starting with a structurally strong car like an Impala, it is up to the creativity and know-how of the owner to make further modifications to maximize his chances of winning. Prepping a derby car is all about protecting the parts of the car that are going to allow it to continue running under all the abuse. Wes Whittaker is one of the most seasoned and successful demo derby drivers in the sport today. Like many others, his life is about cars. He owns a salvage business in Earlville, Illinois, and is an accomplished mechanic.
It's just kind of a hobby we've acquired over the years, and it kind of fits along with our auto salvage operation of tearing cars up, and we just try to repair the car. Actually, you know, a lot of time we have to run maybe an hour demolition derby. Our car has to last that long. You know, so we're learning how to do that still. Every day is an experiment to us, you know, of the different stuff.
It's late winter, and time for him to prepare the car that he will race at an upcoming regional championship. Wes may run in up to 20 demolition derbies in a season, so he always has a full supply of cars in his garage, just waiting to be destroyed in an upcoming derby.
We probably have around 200 of them that we've got and acquired to save.
Wes Whittaker has a wall of trophies and plaques that attest to the fact that he knows how to win a demolition derby. And much of the secret lies in the preparation. He and his friend, fellow derby driver John Ringe, pool their expertise.
First thing when we get a car, we'll bring it into our shop and we'll put it on the hoist and raise it up and we'll remove the gas tank, and because we're always cutting and welding in there and we don't want any flammable material, and then we go right to taking the windows out of the cars.
Although the exact rules and regulations for modifying derby cars can vary from race to race, all derbies have standard safety requirements for cars. Glass and chrome must be removed from cars to protect drivers. Gas tanks must be altered in certain ways to prevent explosions and fires. Hoods, trunks, and doors must be secured shut. These are just a few of the conversions necessary for safe driving. Beyond these requirements, the drivers come up with their own personal tricks of the trade that will allow them to take a beating for as long as possible.
The frame on this particular car here, we got a convertible frame. It's a little tougher right in here. The frame's all boxed in. We put the shifter on this particular one. It has a stop on it where you can shift from forward to reverse without having to go into park or neutral. We put these headers up through the hood here so that we can see when the car is running from the noise and the smoke.
Each car is unique, and each derby teaches Wes some new lessons. No matter how much time he spends on a car, he never knows what his competitors have dreamt up.
It's really tough to play king of the hill and stay there in this sport. You know, you never know what the next guy is thinking up, you know.
But all drivers agree that the car alone will not win an event. Strategy plays an important role in the demolition derby.
Some of these guys have really developed an art form in the driving. You'd think, you just go out there, run around. No. They really, really have a method to their madness. They know exactly what they're doing, especially the guys who've been doing it for many, many years. They really have terrific reflexes. They know how to drive that car in reverse, and they know how to inflict the maximum amount of damage on their competitors. Hit them in the front end, bend the wheel, bend the steering, knock out the radiator. These people are done. And the people that really are winners all the time know this, and they drive accordingly.
You have to hit a car every 30 seconds or 60 seconds, depending on the racetrack. So you have to put yourself in a position where you're going to be able to hit somebody and hopefully drive through them.
After all, Demolition Derby is not just a race, it's a marathon. ABC's Wide World of Sports stopped running the World Championships in 1973, a major gap was left in the sport. At the local level, derbies were still thriving at county fairs, but there was no national competition to allow the nation's best of the best to face off. Today, that gap has been filled by Todd Dubay, who started Dent Productions a few years ago. Dent stands for Demolition Events National Tour.
Dent is the official national championship producer. And there are no other organizations out there. You have other organizations that are doing state level and county level and things like that. Our events do attract the highest caliber drivers. One, because we very, very tightly inspect the cars and we pay good prize money. We respect the drivers.
As opposed to the smaller fairs, drivers put thousands of dollars into these cars. This is serious demolition derby. Today's event is the Dent Southern Regional National Championships held in Fellsmere, Florida.
We have about 96 drivers from all over the United States here competing for a $10,000 purse. Our prize money is broken down through first place is $5,000, second place is $2,000, third place is $1,000. We pay $1,000 in the feature for the most aggressive driver, which we call the Mad Dog Award. And then we also have a $1,000 paint job award, which means if the car is creative and done well, we will nominate it.
These drivers are the cream of the crop because they must have taken a top place in at least one derby the season before.
We use the county fair level to qualify drivers to get into our national championship. You do have to qualify. You have to finish first, second, or third in a feature to qualify to the national championship. And one of the ways that you can qualify is through winning at a county fair level, which helps keep the sport growing and helps maintain the interest for the drivers and upcoming drivers and the fan support.
The drivers arrive a few hours before the event. Because cars without windshields and taillights aren't street legal, they're brought in on flatbeds. The competition quickly checks each other out. National champ Scott Zizelman is here.
I'm the reigning Dent national champ. I qualified by winning last year, and then I won
Probably 15 derbies last summer.
Still, he can't be too confident, especially since a lot of eyes and attention will be on it.
There's a lot of good cars here. It'll be interesting. With winning the championship, my name's been thrown around quite a bit, so it'll be interesting.
Wes Whittaker has arrived with the same car we saw him preparing back in Illinois.
The car looks a little different now since the last time you've seen it, because we put the paint on it, put the frame down, body and everything intact, one piece, and we got everything all welded together where we need it.
Maybe the most famous racer here today is Jesse Meacham, one of the most seasoned drivers and well-known in the glory days of ABC's wide world of sports coverage.
I won world championship in 1968 at Central Islip. That was the first big show that I ever won.
Like most of his competition, he'll also be racing a Chevy Impala tonight.
Chevy Impala. Well, that's what I have to now. I used to like the old 61 and 2 Fords, 63 Fords, Galaxies. They used to be real good, but they kind of outdated, just like me.
Jesse's son, Mark, will race as well. He'll be competing right next to him as they've done many times before.
It's come down to me and him twice, and it's pretty exciting when it comes down to that. There's no favoritism on it, not nothing. You know, if Dad gets in the way, it's it.
Harold Wagner has run in two previous Dent Derbies. He knows that from here on out, there's only one more thing that can help him win.
Luck. That's it. I've done everything to this car I can think of within the rules, and it's going to amount to some luck. I'm going to have to catch a break somewhere.
T.J. Kraft is another well-known veteran. He's been racing in derbies for over 30 years.
Yeah, it's got to be competition tonight. There's a lot of great cars out here, a lot of good cars, a lot of good drivers from all over the United States, and everybody seems to me like they've got a real good chance.
Drivers line up for inspection or teching. Inspection is important as drivers can be easily hurt in this sport.
If you follow the rules, the way they're set up, and you set up your car the way you're supposed to, you can get banged and bruised and stuff like that, but for the most part, it's fairly safe, okay? I say fairly safe because there can be tragedies. It's an accident. You heard the expression, accident waiting to happen? That's a demolition day. It's an accident intentionally going to happen.
The only time I've really seen some people get hurt, we've had some fires. We've had a few people burn because they don't wear fire suits. They wear helmets and usually the shirt they wear to work at the garage.
The announcer calls for drivers in the first heat to begin a lineup. The national anthem is played, and the crowd gets excited.
It's getting down to showtime. When it gets down to showtime, everybody gets a little nervous. I don't care who they are, how many years they've been doing it. From the most seasoned driver down to the rookie, that I've seen some rookies that got so upset that they got sick. I mean, just literally heaved, and that was it. I mean, they really were upset. I've also seen some that got so nervous and so shook up, they basically just passed out and fell over in the seat. Had to be revived. But Everybody gets the butterflies before you get started. Everybody.
Our competitors are lined up and ready to rumble. The starting flag is waved and they are off. Reigning champ Scott Zizelman starts delivering some hard hits from the start. Wes Whittaker gets in the thick of things immediately. He knows you have to play aggressive, but not too aggressive.
Each part of your car will take so many hits, like the front will take 10 or 15 good hits, and your back might take 10 or 15, but you don't want to put 20 hits in the front and wind up with a real good back end of the car. The front end of your car is sticking straight up, so you try to pace yourself, use the back end a little bit, and then the front end a little bit, and the sides a little bit, try to divide the damage that you're going to receive off each part of the car.
T.J. Kraft has also honed his strategy over his long derby career. He knows a big part of winning is having the right attitude.
It takes a special kind of person to do this. You have to be able to roll with punches. You have to be able to swallow your pride every once in a while. Just because this guy comes over and hits you, that doesn't mean he's mad at you. That's just part of the game. And it's a lot of fun, but it does take a special type of person to do it.
As the cars die out, they are unceremoniously removed from the ring. The drivers who qualified for the feature get 30 minutes to fix up their cars as much as possible. Suddenly, it's a mad race of blowtorches, sledgehammers, and tire jacks.
Looks like we've got a little bit of damage. We've got some damage back here. Looks like it's going to have to be hammered down a little bit. We're going to try and hammer down the trunk a little bit, I think. That way, in case it does start coming up, it'll, if it does come up, that'll still give us a little bit more time and make it a bit more compact, too. What we're going to try and do is I'm going to try and get them to pierce it right across here to where it'll start rolling in real good. This one here in the side here was kind of a major hit, but the fellow that gave that to me, I kind of made sure that he understood that I didn't appreciate it, because I put him up against the wall over.
Yeah, we didn't have anything mechanically go wrong. Just like I say, just got to do some body work and change the tires.
At last, it's time for the final feature heat of the night. Scott Zizelman, T.J. Kraft, Wes Whittaker, and Jesse Meacham have all survived to compete for the big win. A red flag goes up to halt the action. There's a problem on the field. A car is on fire. It's number 301, Charles Bulldog Brower, and he's out of the race. The green flag is waved, and the remaining 12 cars continue to pound it out. Then there's another engine fire. The car is ruled dead, and another disappointed driver walks off the field. The action resumes again, and now it's time to get serious. There are just 8 cars left, which resemble impossibly crushed tin cans, but they're still running and still doing damage. The drivers just pray that their radiators hold up for a few more precious moments. As the ring gets cluttered with dead vehicles, Wes Whittaker delivers a final blow to his last challenger. The checkered flag comes out to announce the winner, and it's Wes Whittaker. His hard work and long experience have paid off. He stands in a brilliant mound of twisted metal and broken debris as he is congratulated by his competitors.
Yeah. That's good job. Good job.
When it's time to hand out the awards, there are a few winners. T.J. Kraft takes the Mad Dog Award.
That's Mad Dog Award. It goes to the most aggressive driver.
Wes is given his check for $5,000 by Todd Dubay. He can go home happy, and he starts work on his next car tomorrow.
Where's our big trophy at?
Things come up in my heart and beat.
Believe that human ingenuity will keep derbies alive well into the 21st century.
Demolition Derby caters to fads. Now, at one point, they've had demolition derbies for the little compact cars. I'm sure that when there's an overabundance of SUVs in a junkyard, we will have an SUV demolition derby. No, we'll probably have a minivan demolition derby. We'll probably have whatever. I'm sure down the road, when there's enough of them available, they will do it.
I see myself continuing in the sport as long as I'm having fun. As far as driving goes, I see myself competing as long as I can have fun and not embarrass myself. I love motorsports, any type of motorsports. And for me to be a part of this is an honor and a privilege.
In fact, there have already been several variations on the theme. Including harvester combine derbies. And school bus derbies.
Watch this, look out!
Woo! It seems that where there's a will to crash, there's a way.
Oh, I don't think you'll ever see demolition die. As long as they can roll it, or it can go, I'll bet you someday we'll see an electric car demolition derby. Because if you can crash them and have fun, it's going to happen. It will happen. And as far as the older cars, sure, 1953 Chevy station wagons used to win everything. Later on, 1962 Ford station wagons won everything. No manufacturer has a corner on this market. And when you bring on your electric cars, just make sure that the batteries don't break. And they'll race them. They'll do it.
It's definitely going to be around forever. As long as there's an automobile, a pickup truck that somebody can wreck. Why not? There's always going to be automobiles, as far as I know. And it's still a good form of entertainment and frustrations and all of that. Why not?